You're self-employed.
Oh, sorry to interrupt you. Okay. I'm recording this meeting. Go, yeah. Keep going.
When you're self-employed, things are a little different. The phone rings and you're hoping it's the next job. So the phone rang and it was a gentleman I'd worked with on the Los Alamos project. And he said, "Hey, Barry," I said, "new project?" He goes, "Not exactly." He says, "What do you know about the Shroud of Turin?" And I kind of laughed and I said, but Don, I'm Jewish. And Don laughed and said, "So am I, remember?" He was one of the other Jewish team members. He was an imaging scientist. So to make a long story short, he explained some new technical information that had been achieved on the Shroud, the visualization of the three-dimensional information encoded in the Shroud, which had been proposed over the years, but there was no way of ever kind of proving that until an instrument came along that was able to take the lights and darks of the Shroud image, stretch them into 3D vertical space, and it yielded the natural relief of a human form. And I'll show you that in a few minutes. So I don't want to go in too much detail, but at any rate, that image property, which I knew couldn't be reproduced photographically or artistically, got my interest. So since this was a scientific project, we had team members from Los Alamos and Sandia Laboratories and the Jet Propulsion Lab. As a matter of fact, one of the members of our team, who was in our imaging team from the Jet Propulsion Lab, had been in charge of imaging on all the Voyager, Viking, Mariner, and Galileo projects for NASA. So he was instantly my hero on the team. And so with that in mind, I decided to go ahead and participate and wound up, you know, spending 19 days in Italy, 5 days and nights in front of the Shroud. And of course, photography plays an important role. Remember that the work we did on the Shroud was non-destructive. We couldn't cause any harm to the cloth. So photography in various forms was going to play a really important role in what we did with this piece of cloth. So with that in mind, I'm going to go ahead and start and say that until 1898, no one had, outside of Northern Italy and maybe part of France and Switzerland, had ever even heard of the Shroud, let alone know about it. But in 1898, this gentleman, Secundo Pia, using that camera that you see there, huge camera, was given permission to make the first photographs of the Shroud. And that sort of opened the door. Those photographs could then be distributed, could be reproduced in books or in other publications. And that's when the world began to know about the Shroud. And basically that's when science began to take an interest in the cloth. There I am. Yeah, that's the way I used to look when I had more hair and it was dark. And I used to point out the differences in technology in this photograph. There on the left is Secundo Pia's camera. On the right is one of my Nikons. Today, they're both equally obsolete because they both use film. And of course, today in the modern world, the technology has changed to a point where the old analog days of film are pretty much behind us. And I found that out the hard way a few years ago. I was talking to a group of grade school kids, and a 10-year-old kid put up his hand and he said, "Mr. Schwortz, you keep talking about film. Is that a USB device?" And so that made me feel pretty old because here's a kid who doesn't even know what film is. Yet when I was a kid, you couldn't walk down the street anywhere in the world without seeing a yellow Kodak sign hanging somewhere telling you that you could buy film there. Now, I was in Jerusalem a few years back and I saw a yellow Kodak sign. I took a picture of the Kodak sign knowing that those are gonna be gone any minute now too. So you can see that photography has evolved dramatically since these photographs that I'm showing you and has changed a lot. Making it a lot easier for more people to enjoy and participate in making photographs. And this is what Secundo Pia had to deal with. The Shroud was on display up high inside the cathedral. He had to build a scaffolding and drag that huge camera up there and make his first exposures. And although there was electricity in the Royal Palace, the electricity was fluctuating and his first set of exposures were ruined and he didn't get proper exposure. So he had to go back and do it a second time or a reshoot, if you will. And he had to also photograph the Shroud through glass. So it was very difficult for him to use that 1898 technology to make the images, but this was the resultant image that he did in 1898. And as I said, that opened the door to the research on the shroud around the world, because those images began to reveal what was on that cloth and caught the interest of scientists and researchers all over the world. Now, as soon as Secundo Pia released his photographs, he was immediately accused of fraud, that he had manipulated something and in the dark room or retouched it or something. And it wasn't until 1931, 33 years later, that the shroud was photographed a second time by a gentleman named Giuseppe Henriette. By the 30s, photography had advanced dramatically, the technology had improved, and so the photographs made by Henriette in 31 were much better and much higher quality, better resolution. He didn't have to deal with the reflections that Pia did off the glass. And so and these are the photographs that our team used in our planning to go to Turin and examine the shroud. And we spent 17 months during those planning stages before we actually left to go to Italy to examine the cloth. Now, I mentioned earlier that there was an instrument that our team used. They put a couple of shroud photographs into this device. For some of you, I'll say this kind of looks like a stereo tuner. When I say that to grade school kids, I get a blank stare. They don't even know what a stereo tuner is, but it looks like one. And basically this allowed you to input an image with a black and white video camera. And that screen at the bottom is a green screen display, and it would reveal that image. And there you go. And this is what they saw. And if you look closely, you'll see that you can turn up and down the gain in that top green image, and you could rotate the image. And what we see is the natural relief of a human form. You can see the hands, you can see the fingers, you can see the face, the swollen cheekbones. This was something that had been suggested, but no one had ever been able to verify that those properties existed until this instrument came along. And although it's completely obsolete by today's standards, that was the instrument and these images that prompted the scientists who were looking at them to say, we should put a team together and go to Turin and see if we can get permission to examine the shroud and determine how this image was formed. And it turns out that the guy I had worked with on the Los Alamos project was in the room when this occurred, and they said, we're going to need a photographer. So that's when he called me. Now, a normal photograph will not yield a natural relief. And to show you that, here's a normal photograph in the same instrument called a VP8 image analyzer, vector processor, 8-bit. So it had a very limited grayscale, 8 levels of gray between black and white. So it was a very coarse and unrefined image. But if you look closely, you'll see that the kid on the left's hair goes down into his head, that the kid on the right's face is totally flat. We're not getting the natural relief of a human form. We're getting something. But as you can see, the kids' faces look grossly distorted. This was dramatically different than the results we achieved from the shroud. And this is what actually prompted our team to be formed and to apply for permission and ultimately get permission to go to Turin and examine the shroud. Now, if that information is accurately in the shroud, we should be able to visualize it using other photographic methods. And this is a technique called edge enhancement. And basically, it's a darkroom technique that an Italian photographer, Aldo Goreschi, was able to produce. And you can see very clearly in this image, especially on the left, you can see the facial features, the swollen cheekbones. You can see the hands crossed over the torso, the legs, the knees. So you can see a natural relief of a human form, and normal photographs, as I've shown you, will not do this. Of course, we live in a digital age, so using computer technology, we were able to reveal the same characteristics. So there's three different methods that I've shown you that all reveal that this characteristic, this encoding of depth or spatial information, is in that image on the shroud. So anyway, our team packed up our stuff, and we were working in small groups around the U.S. I was in the California group at the time. We had a group in Colorado, a group back east, a group in New Mexico, where Los Alamos is. And we met for the first time as an entire team a month before we went to Turin in Amsterdam, Connecticut, for what we called the dry run. You can see the big steel table that we had fabricated so we could fasten the shroud onto it with magnets around the periphery so we wouldn't poke holes in it or damage it in any way. And this was our opportunity first to meet each other, the rest of the team, and also to go through our different tests and set up to see what exactly we'd be sort of to practice what we'd be doing on the shroud in Turin. Here you can see a replica, not a particularly good replica of the shroud on the table. And in the foreground, most importantly, you can see there's a rail system. I think I could probably use my pointer here. You can see this rail system here. There's a camera mounted on the rail, two flash units. And this was the setup. And that rail was put in place and then measured. The distance was measured and it was sandbagged in place. The shroud is so long that when I used my large format camera to photograph it, I would have to only photograph, I could only photograph half the shroud at a time and then slide the camera down to the other half and photograph it. Because they did this and did it very carefully, you can see we're using Hasselblad cameras there. Because they did that 20 years later, when I had my 4x5 film digitized, I could go into Photoshop and I put the two halves together and it was a perfect match because they designed and built this system and thought of that well in advance of our getting to Italy. And here you can see using a medium format camera. I'm not going to go into too much technical detail. I'm just trying to get through this to show you exactly how photography played such an important role in the work that we did on the shroud. The shroud was on public display from August to October of 1978. And here you can see people lining up at the cathedral to go in and get a couple of minutes in front of the actual shroud before they were ushered out and the next group came in. 100,000 people waiting in a line, sometimes up to 10 hours. The good news is since then, and the advent of the internet, when they have a public display now, you can go online, go to their reservation system. It doesn't cost anything to register. They just want you to register so they can manage the number of people on any given day. And you can go to their website once a public exhibition is scheduled. And at that point in time, you sign up for it and they tell you show up at the appropriate time. And now on a weekday, you might wait 15 or 20 minutes to get in to see the shroud, maybe an hour on the weekends, but not like this 10 hours, which is what the people in 1978 experienced. Now, when we arrived in Turin, all of our equipment was seized by customs, 80 crates of equipment. And they wouldn't release it to us because we had an X-ray machine with us and there was a radiation sticker on it. Apparently put the fear of God into the customs officials, so they seized all of our equipment. So we were there 5 days early to prepare, to unpack, to set up and calibrate our instruments. And it took them almost all of those 5 days before they finally released it. But since they allowed us into the palace, the royal palace, where we were going to examine the shroud, gave me an opportunity to make some photographs in the Royal Palace. I'm originally from Pittsburgh, PA, not too many palaces in Pittsburgh. So it was an opportunity for me to photograph something I'd never seen before. And that's what these are. This is actually down the hallway, taken from the room in which we examined the shroud in this 400-year-old Royal Palace. This was one of the frescoes that was on the ceiling in the room that we examined the shroud on. This is what you saw when you looked up. Not exactly the laboratory setting that you might expect for a scientific research project. But on the other hand, this is what we were given. This is what we had to do. We didn't have any choices. We just had to make do with what we had. We were fortunate because we were the first group of scientists ever in the history of this cloth to be given permission to examine it. And no one has been given that permission since. So we are the only scientific team in history to do an in-depth, non-destructive test on the shroud. On the fifth day, our equipment was finally released. It arrived at the palace and they said, here you go, unload the truck. And we had to unload all of our equipment. This is a dump truck, by the way. And I promise you that at one moment, we thought the guy was gonna pull the lever and just dump all the stuff out. This is in the courtyard of the Royal Palace. And instead the driver said, no, just unload the truck, please. So we unloaded the truck and moved everything into the palace. And this is a view of just some of our photographic equipment. We had a lot of other kinds of equipment, spectral equipment, X-ray equipment. And I'll show you some of that in a few minutes here, but this is just some of the photo equipment that we brought with us. And here's Vern Miller in the foreground and Ernie Brooks in the background. Sadly, both of them have passed away. Ernie Brooks just this past November, his father founded Brooks Institute that Professor Luna and I both attended. Here we are with the table now set up in that room, having a meeting before the shroud is brought to us. And if you look closely, there's a guy peeking his head around at the end of the table, and that would be me. So you can see that we were set up and planned, but you can see that the environment we were in was not exactly the kind of laboratory setting one might expect. We were doing infrared photography and experiments and thermographic imaging. So we had to cover the shutters of the windows with foil because sunlight was streaming through, and that would wreak havoc with some of the instruments. And so here we are just covering up some of the windows with this foil. Here's that rail system again. The man on the right is the guy who invited me on the team, the guy I did the atomic bomb stuff with. And here we are sitting in the middle is not me, it's Sam Pellicori, he's an optical engineer, and Vern Miller. Here they are setting up. You can see they're measuring the distance, sandbagging the rail system into place so that when you move the camera along that rail, the distance between the camera and the cloth remained exactly the same. Then about an hour and a half ahead of schedule, somebody yelled, "Here comes the shroud." And I went running out into the hallway, and there's a doorway here that leads into the chapel where the shroud had been stored and the cathedral where it was publicly displayed. They brought it through that back door down the hallway into the room where we examine the shroud. And it's a little difficult at this point in time, but if you look really closely, you'll see that the only thing in focus in this photograph is the wall way in the back there. This was kind of a one quick grab shot as they were bringing it down the hallway. And all these guys in the foreground aren't quite in focus. But since this will never ever happen again, having it a little soft rather than a sharply focused image is less critical than capturing that moment, which will never be repeated. You can see that we brought with us not only on that table, notice that there's some gold foil mylar being placed on this table. And the table had removable panels. You can't have steel when you're doing x-rays. So each panel could be removed. Well, when we got the table there after we shipped it across the ocean, the steel had corroded, and they anticipated that might happen. So we had two NASA guys, and this is the same gold foil mylar on the table that NASA uses in the cargo bay of the space shuttle and on satellites. So it's very expensive stuff, but we had a couple of NASA guys. So NASA participated, perhaps unwittingly, but we actually used that to cover those panels. So when the shroud was placed on it, we wouldn't contaminate the shroud with the oxidation that was on the surface of the steel. And here we are moving the shroud off of they had thumbtacked it to a piece of wood. They were worried about us causing harm to the shroud. They thumbtacked it to a piece of wood, so we had to remove all the thumbtacks before we could move the shroud onto our table. And then here it is fastened with those white things around the edges are magnets, bar magnets, that are covered in Teflon, again, so that they're, because Teflon's inert, it would mean that we wouldn't leave any debris or any materials on the shroud. This made sure that we didn't cause any harm. This may well be one of the most well-known photographs I made in 1978. This was in Life magazine, National Geographic, Time, Newsweek, all those places. And I think it just captures the seriousness of that moment where we were looking at the backside of the shroud, lifting it up and just taking a peek at it for the first time in over 400 years. So this is somewhat of a milestone. But I think the thing that makes it powerful is just the expressions on the faces of the researchers doing their work. And one of the other things that we found out was that even though we were in the room with the shroud, they weren't gonna let the Americans go first, so the Italians had to go first. And so this is Professor Rigi and his assistant. He got the idea that the shroud was damaged in a fire back in 1532, and they sewed a backing sheet onto it. So no one had seen the backside in over 400 years. What they did was, they separated a little bit of that and inserted an endoscopic camera between the shroud and its backing sheet to view the backside of the shroud itself. So once again, photography playing a role. And he knew that his endoscopic camera could only see a circular image about 10 centimeters in diameter. So how do you know what you're looking at from underneath when you're seeing it only from the top? He made a string grid of 10 centimeter squares that he could lay on the shroud. And when he turned on his focusing light underneath, he could then center up his image in his camera so he'd know exactly and precisely where on the shroud he was looking at the backside of. When he turned on his focusing lamp, that's the blood stain on the forehead. Notice how dark and dense the blood stain is compared to the area around it. That means that where there is blood and on the shroud, or if there were paint on the shroud that would have soaked into the cloth, when you transmit light through it, you'd see the added density and you'd know that something had been added to the cloth there. All the blood stains look this way. So they, as soon as we saw this, they asked me to, they added something to my list of photographs to photograph the entire shroud with transmitted light passing through it. That way, if there was paint to form the image, we'd see it right away. So I ultimately made these photographs. This is the front of the man of the shroud. And here, if you look, you can see the blood stains on the arms where the arms cross, blood stain of the spear wound on the side. What you don't see is the image itself because there's no paint or pigment applied to create that image. And this is the first scientific evidence we have of that. So those transmitted light photos, which were basically an add-on to the list of things that I had to do, turned out to perhaps be one of the most important set of photos I made in 1978 from a scientific point of view. So here's the shroud, here's the transmitted light. You can see the image doesn't show up with transmitted light because there's no paint or pigment added to put it there. So now, and I'm gonna just go through some of these and I'm putting some words on the screen. I know that you're a college class, but I hate to make you have to read anything. But so I'm just showing you the instruments and I'm showing you the experiments those instruments were responsible for. That way I can kind of go through these. Now, the X-radiography presented us with some very particular problems. You know, going through airports, there are X-ray machines. So we had to use lead foil bags to bring the X-ray film with us to Turin. And we realized that bringing it back through the airports coming home on the way back was risking damaging or fogging the X-ray film. So we had to process the X-rays on site. So we brought with us an X-ray processor. Well, to process X-rays, you need two things. You need a room that can be made dark and you need a water supply. And the only source that matched those requirements in the Royal Palace was the only operating bathroom in that area of the palace that we had access to. So sometimes you just have to make do with what you have. And we wound up having to convert the bathroom into a dark room every time they wanted to process film. And they would come into the room the way we do with our kids when we're going on a car trip. Say, anybody need to use a bathroom? You better go in there right now because it's going to be a dark room for an hour and a half. And we had to use one of the commodes as an overflow for the X-ray processor. But you know, these are the kind of things that what amazed me, even as a member of the team, is how thoroughly planned these guys were to anticipate all of these things and be prepared for literally anything that came along. And this is an example of that. We also did photomicroscopy, photographs through a microscope, a beautiful wild photomicroscope loaned to us by the manufacturer that you can see is being used here to create photomicrographs of the shroud. This is one of the blood stains. You can see the reddish blood stain there. This is the image on the shroud, and you'll notice this yellowish area over here. You can see my pointer, can't you? Yeah.
Yeah, we yeah. can.
You can see this yellowish area. Those are the fibers that make up the image, and notice adjacent to those yellowish areas are white areas where there is no image. So the image is simply a yellow discoloration of some of the fibers. And the darker the image appears, the more of those fibers are together, like a halftone. I don't know if that's been covered in your course, the way halftone works. But if you look at with a magnifying glass at a photograph reproduced in a magazine, you'll see it's made up of little dots. And the darker the area you're looking at, the closer together those dots are. And the lighter the area, the further apart those dots are. So the shroud has a property similar to a halftone. And these are some of the things that we were discovering as we went along. We also did ultraviolet fluorescence photography. One of the theories was that the shroud had the image had been scorched, that someone took a metal statue, heated it up, and laid the cloth on it to scorch it. And the reason they thought that is there are actual scorches from a 1532 fire on the shroud. And those scorches have about the same color, kind of a yellowish color, as the image itself. So the one theory was that it was a scorch. So we did UV fluorescence photography. And you can see here that reveals some things that are not visible to the human eye. This in the center here is the spear wound blood stain on the shroud. And if you look closely around the peripheral of it, there seems to be a lighter halo around the blood stain. Well, that actually is there. That's serum from the blood as the particulates of blood, the liquid separates from the particulates. And that serum is only visible with UV fluorescence photography. So if somebody tells me some forger did this in medieval times, it doesn't make logical sense to me that anybody would even conceive of it. Back to those scorches, on the other hand, and I've taken this from another academic presentation, so I'm just gonna let you read it. But basically what this says is, you can see here some slight reddish colored fluorescence around the scorches. And all the known documented scorches on the shroud fluoresced in the red. You can see the background of the shroud, sort of yellowish green fluorescence. And notice that the image here, the hands, no fluorescence at all. So the image itself is not the product of a high temperature event. Simple as that. Or the image would have fluoresced in the red the way the actual scorches did. So again, fluorescence played an important part. And you'll have to forgive my phone. I've got to shut the ringer off on that one. It's gonna ring four times and we'll live through it. Anyway, continuing on. Again, I've already told you all this, but I'm putting it up on the screen so you can read it at your convenience. Now, I already showed you the transmitted light and reflected light photographs that I made. And you can see this. And you know what's interesting is this is what you see with the eye, but this is what's recorded onto black and white film. And you can see when the lights and darks are reversed on the shroud, you get a much more natural appearing image. This is why some people thought the shroud was made photographically, although it's not. And so you can see that when I back up here, that's what you see. It's a very faint image on the shroud, but when you enhance it and light, do a light dark reversal and increase the contrast a little bit, all of a sudden the image of the man stands out more clearly. And of course, it's much easier to see when I break it into two halves and stand them vertically so that you can see the face, the chest, the hands, all the way to the feet, the back of the head, the shoulders, the back, buttocks, all the way down to the feet. You can see all many scourge wounds on the back of the man's body. So many of the things that are reported in the Gospels, and remember, I'm Jewish, so I'm not coming at this from a theological point of view, but just simply from a factual point of view, this is like a document, a forensic document of what was done to the man's body. Now, one of my other responsibility was to create a set of maps of where each researcher took his data from. And so the way we did that was with magnets, again, coated with Teflon. And I gave a handful of each of magnets to each researcher. They would put a magnet where they took their data from, depending on what their experiment was. And then when they finished in an area, I would come in and photograph it. And here you can see some of these little circular magnets. And based on the position of those, I spent about 2 months in the darkroom creating a set of maps by superimposing these smaller photos over a larger size image, getting them all registered and calibrated and then marking them. And I created a series of maps. Like I say, it took a few months to do this, to create 8 maps. Today I can do it in Photoshop in maybe 2 days. So the technology has advanced dramatically and allowed us you know, we had to work sort of the hard way in the old days. Nowadays, with the modern technology that you all have access to, it's amazing what you can do today that we could only dream of all those years ago. So here are the conclusions of our team. And again, I'm sorry to make you read it, but this is important enough that I'm going to put it on the screen and give you a moment or two to read it, because our primary goal was to determine how the image was formed. Technically, in the end, we couldn't answer that question. We could tell you what it's not. We have scientifically proven, and I haven't used that word very often, we have scientifically proven it's not a painting, it's not a photograph, and it's not a scorch. But as you can see here, when you get the chemistry figured out, the physics is wrong. When you get the physics figured out, the chemistry seems to be wrong. So the only correct answer when I'm asked today, okay, how's the image formed? The only honest and correct answer is we still don't know of a mechanism that can create an image with the chemical and physical properties of the shroud. Now remember, it's only had one scientific examination in its history, and that was 43 years ago. So until another set of testing similar to what we did in 78 is permitted, I'm not yet convinced to go beyond where science is. Many people of faith, look at the shroud and they don't care about the science. To them, this is something very important to their faith. And I recognize and respect that. But from a purely scientific point of view, until another series of tests is permitted, similar to what we did, but using 21st century technology, I'm not yet prepared to set aside the possibility of some natural explanation for this image, although many people consider it miraculous and perhaps even a result of the resurrection. Again, that's a personal choice that people make based on their beliefs and their faith, which I greatly respect. But from my point of view, being part of the only scientific research done directly on that cloth, so far the science can't answer that basic question, how is the image formed? And with that, I'd be happy to take some questions. How am I doing on time, Jeffrey?
You're good. The class has another 20 minutes. So we can just go to the end if you want.
Well, this was my stopping spot to try and stay within your time frame. However,
you're good. Yeah.
Before you get up, the next part of the talk, which I'll be showing again at St. John's University this coming Tuesday, is proof that the shroud is not made photographically. Do you want me to proceed with that?
Yeah. Could you talk on that? Because there have been even some shows on TV that a photographer, you know,
that's what prompted me to produce this.
Yeah. So let's hear about that.
Okay, so there's a guy, so was the shroud's image actually made using photography? There's a gentleman, now these are the theories I've already told you it's not a painting, it's not from a statue or a rubbing of iron oxide, which is an artistic form. But some people theorize that the image is a medieval photograph possibly produced by Leonardo da Vinci. Okay, when I first heard this, I thought they were joking me, because the shroud is documented being publicly exhibited 100 years before Da Vinci was born. But we'll set that aside for a moment. Let's talk about why the shroud isn't a photograph. First of all, in 1995, this gentleman, Nicholas Allen, the one you've seen in the TV shows, Jeffrey, claimed the shroud image is a medieval photograph. And he said it was made using a camera obscura, which means dark room in Latin. So there's a dark room. There's a small hole at one end of the room. There's a statue placed outside in the sunlight. And there's inside the room an image formed on a cloth that's been treated with silver nitrate or silver salts to make it light sensitive. And according to Mr. Allen, the exposure was 4 days long, 4 days. Now, if you hung a body in the sunlight for 4 days, I assure you, it might start looking like a body on the first day, but by the end of the fourth day in direct sunlight, I think it's not going to look so much like a body anymore. But this is what Nicholas Allen has claimed. So let's address that, because the one thing Nicholas Allen never did, he never took his photograph, put it next to a shroud photograph, to compare them side by side, but I did. And I have to give Alan credit, because he didn't just hypothesize and theorize, he actually produced an image photographically. So, and it was based on his image that these two British researchers came up with the Leonardo da Vinci theory. Well, like I said, Nicholas Allen never made that side-by-side comparison, but you can't make a claim that this is how the shroud was formed without first comparing the two images. So notice Allen's image shows a very strong directionality of light from above. Notice it's slightly overexposed here. The shoulder is overexposed. The arms, top of the arms are overexposed. And here, let me go to the labels. Notice the shadow under the chest, under the hands, the overexposed knee and the overexposed feet. So you can see the light was obviously straight up above and came straight down, casting those shadows and those highlights as you see them. This is what one would expect from a photographic image, no problem. Look at the shroud image, on the other hand, there's no directionality of light at all. There's no shadowing, there's no highlighting, but if you look around the hands, you'll see that there's a correlation between the image on the shroud and the distance it was from the cloth when the image formed. And because the hands across the torso lifted the cloth away from the body, you'll see in this photo here, a darker area around the hands because the distance was further because the hands lifted the cloth away from the torso. So as you can see, there is no directionality. So this is not anything like what Nicholas Allen shows. And here's the example that I'm giving about the distance. I'm gonna go through this pretty quickly, but the image grows more faint up to about 4 centimeters. And after that, there's no imaging at all. That also makes measuring the length of the body on the shroud more difficult. Never mind the fact that the cloth is woven, it can stretch in any direction dramatically, that its shape can change based on the relative humidity in which it's stored. So doing direct measurements on the cloth is difficult because at the edges, there's a very sharp and distinct edge around Nicholas Allen's image. It's a properly focused photograph. The shroud image just fades out gradually at its periphery. So even doing precise measurements from the shroud is difficult. So anyway, no photographic imaging can create an image based on distance like that. And here's that example that I'm showing you with the hands. And you can clearly see that circular area around the hands where the shroud is, where there's less exposure of the torso because the hands have lifted the cloth further away from the body. And there you can see it again in a black and white version of it. So here we go. And there's the sharp edges I was talking about. Notice the shroud image just fades out at the edges. So we can eliminate photography just based on these things. And that's the other thing. Our team was able to determine that there's no image under the blood stains. The implication is that the blood stains got onto the cloth by direct contact with the body. And wherever there was blood, that inhibited the image formation mechanism. That means that an artist trying to fake this would have had to put forensically accurate blood stains on the cloth before he created the image. Obviously, that's not possible. It would be hard to do that today, even in Photoshop. So I'm going to put this up there for you to read. Like I said, I hate to make you read stuff, but you're a college class. You guys can handle it. And I'll leave that up. Or you are recording this, aren't you, Joe?
Yes.
So that there might be time that if you had to, you can always pause on playback to read it if I don't give you enough time, because I'd still like to leave some time for questions if you have any. Okay. Here's the actual first photograph documented in the world, and that negative still exists in the University of Texas archive. This is by Nietzsche Nietzsche, and this is 1826 or 27. And you can Google this and you can find this for yourself. So the first photograph ever, 1826. The shroud we know goes back at least to 1200, 1300s. So obviously nobody invented photography back then, or we'd be giving credit to Da Vinci for inventing photography, which he didn't do. here is some of the scientific work, and I'm not going to make you read this. I'm just going to go through this quickly. But the spectral analysis confirmed all of the other data that I've mentioned to you. Like I say, I'm going through this pretty quickly, but you can spend, you can go to shroud.com. And I always tell people, when you go to shroud.com, pack a lunch and a snack. You'll be there for a while. And we took Nicholas Allen's image, put it in the VP8. On the left, you can see the chin juts out, the gross distortion in the face. So the VP8 shows that the result that Nicholas Allen achieved did not give us the same result that we have on the Shroud. So the Shroud wasn't made with the camera obscura. I'm going to go through these pretty quickly. These are some of the other papers. This is the peer-reviewed science that proves there is this correlation of image density to distance on the Shroud. And as for Leonardo doing it, you know, he was a great artist, but he wasn't that good. Okay. So I think that that's the last slide. Yeah, we didn't leave it on that. Anyway, so that is, in a nutshell, how photography has played such a critical role in the study of this very important object. It's just an important object to a billion people or so on this planet, just based on their faith. And of course, there are countless researchers, scientists, historians interested in the Shroud from their perspective, because I came at it, I didn't have any emotional attachment to the subject matter. I guess maybe that's what makes me a good spokesman for the science, because technically I don't have a horse in the race, if you know what I mean. And what it means is, to me, that my obligation as the man who documented this and has preserved the work of our team and the other research that's occurred over the last 40, 45 years, that means that the next generation of researchers are in a much better position to bring themselves up to date on what we know about the Shroud, because I've collected it all and put it all into one place. And somebody once asked me how I got the name shroud.com. And the answer is real simple. In 1995, when I secured it, it was available. So it's amazing how things have changed. We just got an offer of $500,000 to buy our domain name. And our domain is not for sale, obviously. But it's kind of interesting to see the impact this has on people. And maybe the success of our website is what I wrote on the front page, and you can visit it and see it for yourself. But one sentence is maybe the smartest thing I ever wrote. I said that given the facts, I have to believe that you need to make up your own mind about this. I'm not telling anybody what to believe or how to believe. Here's the evidence, you decide. And that's been the success of Shroud.com. We don't promote any particular theory. And in fact, we even include the skeptics' theories, because you can't have a complete picture of what we know about the Shroud without hearing what the skeptics have had to say, and then looking at the countermeasures that have been applied to challenge those skeptical claims.
All right. Wow, what a great presentation. Let's, why don't you stop share screen, Barrie?
Okay. Let me see if I can figure out how to do that.
I think down at the bottom there's a green button.
Oh, right up on, yeah, I see it.
Right up on top. Yeah, right.
Okay, there you go.
Oh, good. All right, let's see if we, I did ask people to put their questions in through text. Let's see if I can go to those messages. Let's see. At a loss here. Usually they just show up on the right.
Yeah, I'm not seeing anything. I'm just seeing everybody's smiling faces. Well, maybe not everybody's smiling. Or I am not smiling. Now smile. There you go.
Let's see. Oh, the chat. Okay, let's open up the chat.
Okay.
So, okay. So Faz and Catherine ask, was there another figure on the opposite side of the image shown?
You mean on the opposite side of the visible shroud image?
Yeah.
No. In other words, the image did not penetrate through the cloth. It, as a matter of fact, the image lives in a couple of microns on the top surface of the fibrils. I think I showed you in that one photomicrograph, those yellowed fibers.
Yeah.
And they're just the top layer of fibers, and it didn't penetrate any further. So on the reverse side, there are blood stains. The blood stains, as we would expect, penetrated through the cloth via capillarity, but no image on the reverse. Good question.
Interesting. Okay.
Catherine still had another question, I think. Huh?
Well, is it okay if I ask you?
Yeah.
By instead of writing it. The only thing is because you showed an image where it showed like him, that, you know, laying there, and then it was a bigger image, and no, then it showed the other side, like as if head to head.
Yeah. And the reason you see that is he was laid on the cloth with his feet at one end, and his head then came to about the middle of the cloth. Then the cloth was folded over and back to his feet. So on the inside is his front and back head to head with about that much space in between that one would expect for the top of the head, which was not imaged, probably because when they did that, the cloth was more than 4 centimeters from the top of his head.
Yeah.
Good question, though. Good observation.
So Jim Howes, a former colleague and student of mine, and also a retired police officer, asks, have you ever been involved in using these processes in crime scene investigations?
I have not, but many of the techniques, Jim, are techniques that are currently, I mean, nowadays, of course, with the forensic files on television, we're all so familiar now with the technologies. Of course, on TV, they always solve the crime in 43 minutes. Jim, you know that isn't always really the case, but those types of forensic applications have been applied to the shroud. As a matter of fact, on our team was a man named Dr. Robert Buckland. Dr. Buckland was the guy they based the television show Quincy on. Now, those who don't have gray hair may not remember that show, but some of us do. And the Quincy show, not only was he the kind of the model for the Quincy character, he was an advisor to the producers of the show. And he was a forensic pathologist and at the time assistant coroner in Los Angeles. There's another gentleman, Dr. Frederick Zugabe, both of them passed away now. Dr. Zugabe was the medical examiner at Rockland County, New York, as he put it, where all the mob guys dumped all the bodies in Rockland County, north of the city. And he did that for 35 years. Between the two of them, they had performed over 50,000 autopsies. And both of them, Zugabe made a 50 plus year study of the effects of crucifixion on the human body, applied that knowledge to the shroud itself. And his paper and his works are published in a book called The Crucifixion of Jesus, a Forensic Inquiry. So yes, real expert forensic pathologists have studied the shroud. There was an anthropometric study done where they took measurements of the long bones, the arms and legs, and then applied the anthropology tables that, you know, anthropologists use for determining what part of the world a person might come from. They determined that the man of the shroud is a Semitic male. I knew that the first time I saw a photo of it. It looked like my grandfather, who was also a Semitic male. So the forensic applications that are now become very familiar to everybody have absolutely been applied to the shroud. And without an exception, the experts conclude that this is a real body, that the blood stains are not painted on, but are actual blood from direct contact with the human body. This is the real thing. This is not some artistic interpretation.
Yeah. You know, I can add to that, that I was the photographer that ran the photography department for the Alameda County District Attorney's Office for a couple of years. And so we were always looking at forensic evidence. And so back then we were using the same infrared and fluorescence. That was the two things that we used a lot. So that was, but you know, the technology's really gotten better since then.
Well, you mentioned infrared.
Yeah.
The infrared sensors that we had in 1978 could barely detect the difference between the image and the background, because the image at its darkest point is only about 20% darker than the background. So yeah. The sensitivity of the infrared sensors at the time could barely detect that. They did by shining a light on the shroud, allowing it to absorb some of that, and then immediately applying the thermographic cameras. And so they were able to get something. But if you read the peer-reviewed journal paper that was published by the infrared guys, they said that the limitation was in their technology at this point. Today, that technology is so far beyond what we did in 1978. And this is why I'm not prepared to set aside the scientific answers to this image until another set of in-depth, non-destructive testing can be performed on the shroud using 21st century technology. And so, you know, look, I came into this purely from a scientific point of view. I still view it that way, but I also respect that this is an object of faith to a billion or so people. And I try and show that same reverence and respect that it deserves.
Here's a question from my student, William. Was this scientific study technically considered to be the origin of the shmata business?
Of the what?
Shmata business.
That's Yiddish.
Yeah.
Is this a tongue-in-cheek question?
Yes, it is.
Yeah. No, for those who might not know, the term shmata is a word for rag.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Okay. This is from Colin Anderson. He's in Wales. Great presentation. Fascinating stuff. Is there one technique that Barrie would love to be able to try out now, 43 years since his investigation of the shroud?
Well, I think, well, it's pretty hard to narrow it down to one. And people have said to me, well, if they put another team together, are you going to be on it? You're going to go and do this again? And my answer is, no, I'm not. I'm retired. I have not kept up with the technology as it's evolved, especially over these last 10 years or so. I think it's time for a young guy who's an expert in the use of these most modern technologies to be a part of it. And then I also point out the fact that I was there first. How many times did Hillary climb Everest? That's all he needed once. So I don't need to do it again. There's no ego about this. I think that it would be best served if another round of testing is ever permitted to get young people who are experts in the most recent up-to-date technology and allow them to apply that. So it's hard for me to see, you know, to say what one particular test. There's a whole battery of tests that I would like to see performed, not so much just to duplicate what we did, but to apply some of the newer technologies. Our spectral instruments were very powerful in 1978, but it was a big machine on a cart that had to be wheeled around. Today, a small handheld instrument could do the exact same thing we did in 78. Not just do it, but do it way better than what our technology was at back then. So I would like to see a repeat of all those tests. In part, look, we went there to answer one question and came back unable to really answer that. So I'd like to see us go back and try and answer it again and perform a similar set of tests. But the other thing is this, the data we brought back in 78, photographic and otherwise, was a massive amount of data. And guess what? Not only did we come back with a few answers to some of the questions, we came back with 1,000 new questions. And so another round of testing not only could help us further our knowledge of the image, but also perhaps answer some of the questions raised by the data that we collected from the shroud that still remains published in the peer-reviewed journals, but you know, raising other questions that can't be answered by that data, and new data would be needed. And I think everybody involved in shroud research feels the same way, that we'd be best served with another round similar to what we did before. Again, a diverse group, experts in their individual fields, chosen specifically for their expertise. That's how our team was chosen. So there were 3 Jewish guys and some atheists, some agnostics, a Mormon or 2, a couple of Catholics and Protestants. We were very diverse, and people have criticized me for not publishing on shroud.com the religious affiliations of all the team members. I'd have to know them first. That was never a criteria for membership. And frankly, had that been a criteria for membership on the STIRP team, most of those guys wouldn't have participated. These were guys who built bombs and atomic bombs and explosive experts. So to call them a bunch of religious fanatics, I don't think so.
We have a real good question here. It comes from Thad Waterbury. He's the photography professor here at the college that does the film class. This relates to a question that I have, so I'm going to present them all at the same time. Sure. His was, where was the Shroud for the first 1,300 years? And this relates to the results, which are, I believe, flawed, which were the carbon 14 tests,
sure,
which is something that really, really needs to be revisited, because that is something that was flawed. So,
hey, what, bring me back again and I'll do my radiocarbon dating lecture for you. Okay. That answers all those questions in detail, but let me give you a short answer. Yes, the radiocarbon dating in 1988 came back and said, Shroud of Turin, 1260 to 1390, that was the range. But some of us knew about a document, an illuminated manuscript in Hungary called the Prey Codex. And that shows an illustration of the Shroud, showing the herringbone weave, showing the hands crossed. And think about this, artists throughout history, when depicting Jesus, always show him with a modesty cloth, right? That's what an artist has the artistic license to do. Man of the Shroud is naked. Now, here we have an illustration from an illuminated manuscript dating 1190, 75 years earlier than the earliest possible date given by the carbon dating guys. And there's a set of L-shaped burn holes on the Shroud from a previous event undocumented. And this guy included them in his illustration. Do you think that was an accident to put it four burn holes in an L shape in his little illuminated manuscript? He must have seen the Shroud. If he saw the Shroud, it had to be prior to 1190. And that's already blows away the radiocarbon dating. So those of us who knew about the Prey Codex knew there was something wrong, but we didn't know what it was. So since we don't have a lot of time, I'm going to cut to the chase here and tell you that we have since learned that the problem with the radiocarbon dating wasn't with the radiocarbon dating. The problem with the radiocarbon dating was the fact that they only chose one little strip sample from one corner of the Shroud and not one sample from anywhere else on that huge piece of cloth. And it turns out that that sample was from an area that had been repaired. It had been rewoven. There was cotton found mixed in, which is forbidden by Jewish law, by the way. You can't mix cotton and wool with linen. It's called a mixing of the kinds. Anybody who's studied the biblical stories knows about that. And yet we find cotton interwoven, and not only cotton, but once that interwoven repair was done, obviously the cotton was going to be a different color than the linen itself. So they applied a dye with rose madder dye from the madder root plant in a gum arabic base. And we chemically found that in the Shroud radiocarbon dating sample. That sample was what was wrong, not the carbon dating. If they had only taken one little piece from anywhere else on that cloth, I guarantee you they would have gotten a dramatically different date. And there are now five peer-reviewed journal papers starting from 2005 up until just 2019 that challenged the radiocarbon dating. There's a whole big story behind it that we don't have time to go into, but I will tell you this, that there's no doubt in my mind that that radiocarbon dating is in error based on that. And the last paper that came out, there's a French researcher who also happens to be a legal student. And he decided to go to England, where one of the three labs were, and the three labs had been supervised by the British Museum. And the gentleman from the British Museum, the three labs over 27 years refused to release the raw data. And if any of you have studied or done any research in science, you know that once your paper is published in a peer-reviewed journal, you can release the raw data so that other researchers can try and duplicate or evaluate your work properly. For 27 years, the three labs refused to release the raw data until this young man from France went to England, used the Freedom of Information Act, and forced the British Museum to release the data. He then brought on some experts in analysis of these numbers and this data. And they determined that along the strip that was cut, at one end of the strip, you get one date and you get hundreds of years earlier or later on the opposite end of the strip. So that strip is not homogeneous, it's inhomogeneous. And that means you can't use that strip to determine the date anywhere else on that cloth. It's just not credible. And yet that's what's happened. And of course, you know, Shroud is a fake makes a much better headline than science says something else. And so we've dealt with that. And, you know, I deal with that on a regular basis, especially because I have a pretty high profile in that world now. But look, I don't have any reason to believe this is authentic. Certainly, there's no emotional attachment. I mean, other than the fact that Jesus was one of our boys, you know. But I don't have any reason to do anything but tell the truth about this. That's what makes this so easy for me. The science is the truth. It's documented. It's taken directly from the cloth. And I've had, you know, I've debated skeptics, and I've had skeptics say, well, of course, that peer-reviewed science is false because it's the rantings of believers. Well, I have to point out that when I have an instrument and I point it at a piece of cloth and I pull the trigger, that instrument doesn't care what my religious background is or who I voted for or whether I live in a red state or a blue state. It doesn't care about any of that. It records the data, and the data is published. So if you don't like the conclusions of the SERP team, look at the data, draw your own conclusions. It's all readily available for you on shroud.com.
So in answer to that, where was the shroud for the first 1300 years? We don't know.
We don't know, but we have clues. And again, history is not my strongest suit here. I'm an imaging guy, what can I say? But there is evidence in the historic record of something called the Mandylion, which translated from the Greek means not made by hand, not an artwork, in other words. And it was supposed to depict the image of Jesus. There's the Abgar legend that somebody brought a cloth to King Abgar, who was sick, and it healed him. I don't know if that part of it is accurate or not, but there are all these references, and the Mandylion was in Constantinople, and then the Crusaders came and they sacked the city, and the Mandylion, which had been hidden in a wall, disappeared, never to be seen again. And 150 years later, a French knight whose great-grandfather had participated in the sacking of Constantinople, Geoffrey de Charnay, shows up with the shroud that we know today. Is that a coincidence? So yeah, there are big gaps. Because look, think about this. From a Jewish perspective, it's forbidden to have something with blood on it. It has to be buried with the body. When I first read the New Testament, and I read about the second cloth, the face cloth that would have contained his blood and pleural fluids, and it said it was folded and separate, but in the tomb to be buried with the body, authentic Jewish burial. I knew that right away. And so obviously the people who put Jesus in the tomb were following the Jewish tradition of an authentic Jewish burial. So where was it during those years? There are books by Ian Wilson, and I suggest anybody who really wants to get into it, read it, because it's way more complicated that I can tell you in a brief interview like this.
Janet Alcaldi, a student of mine, asks, would there be a way to do a DNA testing without harming the fabric, or has that already been done? And there was blood typing done.
There was.
Yeah, I don't know about the DNA.
Well, let me address the DNA real quick, because like I said earlier, we watch DNA solve a crime in 43 minutes on a TV show every day. There's a problem with DNA, however. That piece of cloth has been handled by thousands of people through the centuries. And back in 2008, we finally learned that we're shedding epithelial cells constantly. And those if I leaned over the shroud, I left my DNA on it. I touched it, I left my DNA on it. And I happen to be a long-haired Jewish guy like the man of the shroud. So the problem with DNA analysis is, whose DNA are you really testing? And when you consider how many people have had access to it over the years, and then we have what happened in 2002, they decided to do a restoration. They removed all the patches that had been sewn in 1532 or 1534 to repair the damage of the fire 2 years earlier. And They got a Swiss textile expert and her lady assistant, and they spent 32 days. They removed all the patches. They scraped and vacuumed away the scorched areas. They removed the backing sheet of the cloth and sewed a new backing sheet on with no chemical analysis to determine if the new cloth had ever been treated in a way that might be harmful to the shroud. And for 32 days, these two women handled the cloth with no gloves, no hairnet, no mask or protective clothing. Consequently, if we were to do a DNA analysis of the man of the shroud today, we'd find he was a Swiss woman.
Yeah. All right.
True. I mean, you know, you have to understand that a lot of the tests that we kind of take for granted in the modern world are very difficult to apply to the shroud. First of all, because now we don't, nobody's been given permission to look at it in 43 years, other than the public exhibitions. And there's one coming up April 3rd. It's going to be on television and on social media, live from the cathedral. They're going to pull it out, and they're not going to set it up for display. They'll pull it out the way they did a year ago. And if you go to shroud.com and click on the headline on the front page, it'll take you right to the article from the Archbishop translated into English, so you can read about it and find out the details if you want to see it on April 3rd, which is the day before Easter, Holy Saturday.
Oh, Barrie, I want to thank you so much for taking the time to give us this this really in-depth and interesting look at how photography can be used in so many different ways. And this is just one of them. But it's one of the biggest mysteries in the history of the planet.
Well, and I want to say this too, that I understand that many of you that are taking this course don't intend to become professional photographers. I understand that. But one of the greatest things about the advances in the technologies, back when I was learning photography as a young lad and had my first darkroom at age 14, we had to make the photographs and then wait for the film to get processed to find out if we even got anything. Yeah. Now, for the larger format cameras, we had Polaroids that we could use in our 4x5s and even in our Hasselblads. But nowadays, click, there it is. You can output it to your big screen. If it's perfect, you're done. You already know that. We didn't have that benefit. So we had to bracket our exposures in some cases. We had to do testing on a roll of film. We'd have the first couple of frames clipped off and processed normally to determine if that was a good processing or if the processing needed to be adjusted. Those aren't things that you have to worry about anymore. And no, film is not a USB device.
Yeah, that's funny about clip testing. I hadn't thought about that for
a minute. I did that for everything.
Yeah, absolutely, yeah. And the film changed colors. So when you bought a big box of film, you'd buy it in bulk, you'd test it. And it started out green and then it went to magenta over a period of months, even if it was in the freezer.
Yeah, although in the freezer slowed the process down. Yeah. So, but film did have an active shelf life, if you will.
Yeah.
Of course, digital, all of those have been removed. And the beauty of digital today is now you can, I mean, all you need is one of these now.
Yeah.
You know, and the beauty of it is you can look at it. If you don't like it, hit the delete button and try again. So it's a lot more fun than it used to be because it's much more immediate. That was the biggest frustration in the early days, why I built my own darkroom at age 14, because I didn't want to wait for it to come. Plus it cost money. And at age 14, I didn't have much. So it was much easier to do it myself. And that's where I kind of started.
Well, some of us miss film because if you were an expert at shooting and processing, you were out there kind of in that 1 or 2% of people that could actually deliver a quality image.
That's right.
You know, now we can't get paid for that because it's...
Well, the analog days required us to have a much broader base of knowledge, both from a chemistry and understanding different film types and their characteristics, none of which is important anymore. Now the cameras have built-in auto white balance, auto black balance. Right now I'm lit with a 3200 degree Kelvin ring light, which you've seen in my glasses here. And over there is a big window and sliding glass door. So on this side, it's daylight over 5,000 degrees Kelvin. you don't have to worry about any of that because the camera doesn't. Look, the camera in my computer has made it look correct automatically. In the old days, we needed filters to make that work.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
It's a much better, easier, and more enjoyable form now than it was back in the old days.
Well, again, I want to thank you so very much for taking the time. I know my students appreciated it. I did. I learned a whole bunch of new stuff, and I have been reading that. I've been almost every day on shroud.com reading various things to kind of get up to speed. And so thank you so much. Say hello to your cat.
Now this is Smarty.
Smarty.
Well, when he was a kitten, you know, there's a space above the keyboard between on the laptop, and he jumped up onto the laptop, but walked only on that space and never touched one of the keys. And he was just a little kitten. I said, what a little Smarty you are. And that became his name.
Well, thank you so much. Students, I want you to stay on because I have to talk about the assignment for next week. Okay. But well, Barrie, thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Thank you, students. Many of them look at least they're as old as I am. And some are not, obviously. But thank you guys for being attentive and for letting me come in and show you what we have learned about the Shroud and how important photography really was.
Okay, great.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Take care. I'm going to hit the leave button.
All right.
Thank you.
I'm out of here. Bye-bye.
Bye. Okay, so wow, that was really something, wasn't it? And, you know, I noticed that no one asked Barrie if he believed that the Shroud was real or not. I was really surprised that no one asked that question. You can find the answer to that on shroud.com. He really does, because I think his answer will surprise you. Anyway, so this week we have an assignment that is about composition. And I have 10 rules of 10 of the most common rules of competition. You have to turn in 10 photographs for this upcoming assignment. It's there are 3 videos that are on the assignment posting that I put up. I want to just let you know that the assignment is described in the second video. The third video talks about Fibonacci, who was a Italian philosopher and scientist and artist. There's an assignment at the end of that Fibonacci video. Do not do that assignment. Do not do that assignment. Just do the assignment that I believe is on the part 2. Composition part 2, but I do want you to watch all 3. If you've had the class before, if you did the beginning class, this will seem like a very familiar assignment because we had a very similar assignment. I did change the content of the video since then, but it's an assignment that I give for every single class. The composition assignment. So I look forward to seeing your, what you have to do. And I'm sorry I couldn't get through all of the critique. So we will continue, we'll complete the critique of our 6 persona assignments next Friday, because I don't want to rush through it. And some people have already left. And there's some really good submissions, and I want to make sure that you see every one of them because they were really terrific, really, really heartwarming for me to see everybody make such good progress on the class. So thank you so much. So I think that's going to do it for this week. And thank you for attending. And if you have any comments that you want to give, you can email them to me and I'll forward them to Barrie. I know that he'll like to hear from you, and or you can contact him directly through the website. He's very transparent. He has his His personal email is right at the bottom of shroud.com. So I hope you'll go there and visit it. And it's a great, great subject. It's a huge mystery. It's really great subject.
Thank you for sharing with us.
Yeah, my pleasure. I was excited to have him.
About that thing he said about the old-time photography. One time I had a client, my brother-in-law, took some fish and came to me and said, "Wow, look at this huge fish. Can you take some pictures for me?" I did it. I had a Canon, click, 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 click. And a couple of days later, he said, "Did you print it?" I went home, I looked at the camera, I forgot to put the film in there. Yeah. He was going to kill me.
Well, that's a good thing that the Shroud team didn't make that mistake, huh?
Thank you, Professor.
Yeah.
Thank you. Bye, everybody.
Thank you very much. Okay, you guys, I'll see you next Friday. And please look at the assignment that I posted and send me any questions you have. Okay. All right. I'll see you next week.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye.